Hello, and welcome to this series on Windows Server 2012 R2, The Essentials Experience, where we'll be covering the features and functionality that was previously only available in the Essentials Edition, but is now also available as a role in the Standard and Data Center Editions as well. So here in part one, we'll just give you an overview of the Essentials experience. So taking a quick look at our agenda, we'll just kick things off with a brief context of what's happening in the market today, talk a little bit about our Ahead of the Game campaign, and then we'll dive into a features overview. And this I've broken up into our three main areas where we've collected together the different pieces of functionality. So we'll talk about how Essentials helps you protect your data, provide secure remote access, and also integrate with cloud services. And then finally, we'll just wrap up with some next steps that you can take. So to get things started, we'll talk a little bit about staying ahead of the game in today's market. So one of the things that we know is that the game is changing. So there is a move on to use the applications and services that are available in the cloud. So we see a lot of growth happening here in the small and mid-sized business segment. So which is not to say that all tasks or all functions or all applications are moving into the cloud, but that there is sort of a hybrid technology approach that's being adopted and growing in prominence. So understanding what you can do with the cloud and more easily integrating it into on-premises solutions is becoming more and more important. Also, of course, we're seeing increasing use of mobile devices and working remotely. So one of the things that I'm sure that you've seen in your customer environments or in your own environment is just the increasing use of smartphones and tablets and different devices and different work styles that are remote from a physical office location. And then finally, another trend that we're seeing is, and it's a long-running, long-established trend, is using data to compete with other customers, other competitors in the market. So it's a high priority for SMBs to really improve the experience for their customers and to really take advantage of the data that they have. So one of the things that we know with the economy starting to improve now, but we've really been in a belt tightening few years, so there's always this continuous pressure to do more with less and really to make maximum use of the resources that you have. You want to be able to work wherever you want to work and whenever you want to work. So you want to be able to get the job done quickly and get it done right and give employees and give people the freedom to work where they want to and to be able to do that in a secure way, to be able to collaborate with people, whether they're local to the office or remote from anywhere they may be. And you also want to focus on efforts that win you business. So you need to target the opportunities that give you the most growth potential, the most profitability, and help you win sales in your market. So being able to look at the data that you have and really analyze that well and extrapolate with that is going to give you a huge leg up in the environment. So following on that, we've created the Stay Ahead of the Game campaign, which really helps to focus in on those areas where technology can help you win and to be a leader. So we've broken this up into three different pillars here. We also have three full days of instructor-led training that map against this campaign. So do follow up in your areas for the availability of these courses. They are free to take, and again, they are full day instructor-led courses. The first one is around Be Lean and Stay Lean, so this is the first of the three pillars in the campaign, and really focuses on how to make maximum use of your technology investments, and it focuses on virtualization and server consolidation, as well as the modernizing your storage infrastructure, using things like storage spaces, and just understanding what you can do with the modern operating systems that we have. Also, the second pillar is our Business Anywhere pillar, where we're really talking here about giving employees the flexibility to work remotely, to work with the devices that they have and want to use, and to be able to work where and when they want to. And then finally, the last pillar of the campaign is to tap your data goldmine. So we know that businesses have a lot of information about how they've been doing and about how their customers are behaving, and just a lot of information that they know if they could analyze well that they would truly help them to take the next step in growing their business and being more successful. So these three different areas there then make up the Stay Ahead of the Game campaign. As we look at essentials and how that can help and how the different features and functionality also address some of these needs, we have organized this into three main areas as well. So the first one, again, a long-standing need that we see for small businesses and medium-sized businesses is just the capability of protecting your data. And so especially if you're moving out of a peer-to-peer network where data is kind of on this PC and that PC, and sometimes it gets backed up and sometimes it doesn't, and everybody has access to all the information no matter how sensitive it is, and really wanting to take the next step to protect that data and control access to that data. And Essentials helps you do that. It helps centrally store information, which helps to simplify backing it up. It has business continuity support and disaster recovery components to it in terms of when you virtualize, you could take advantage of things like Hyper-V Replica to really provide a very robust business continuity solution for those small businesses who previously wouldn't be able to afford traditional approaches. It also provides just a simplified management infrastructure with the dashboard to, again, help protect that whole environment and to make sure that it's healthy. Also, we have a number of different things to help provide secure remote access so that employees can be productive on a consistent basis no matter where they are, give several different options to easily connect in and do that in a secure way so that you're able to have confidence that when you're working, whether it's local or remote, that that your data, again, is protected. And then finally, being able to integrate easily with cloud-based applications and services. And this really provides quite a lot of flexibility and agility to the business. You really only pay for what you want and what you are actually using. And working with Essentials and the Essentials experience helps to improve the management of a range of cloud-based applications and services by providing add-ins that allow you to manage those in the same way that you would manage local resources. The next thing just to mention as we get started here is a couple of the big new changes with Essentials in terms of deployment options that you have. So the first one is that you can now use Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials, the Windows Server Edition, as its own Hyper-V host. So in previous versions, the Essentials Edition couldn't be its own Hyper-V host. It could run as a virtual machine, which it can still do, but you had to have some other hypervisor. And with 2012 R2, we've made it so that you can actually buy a single license of the Essentials Edition and use that to run your Hyper-V host and then to be a guest virtual machine running on that host. And then the second thing that we've done is to take all of the features and functionality that make up the Essentials experience and package them into a role that's available on the other editions of Windows Server as well, so the standard and data center editions. And this role is the Windows Server Essentials experience. So with that as context, I wanted to just give an overview of the different features of the product. And again, we're going to organize those around our three pillars. So the first one being protect your data. And one of the things that was very interesting for folks when we introduced Essentials and even the home server edition of Windows, which came along before that, was the idea of being able to do complete client computer backups. So as you add computers into the Essentials environment, then they get set up automatically to be backed up on a nightly basis, or you can determine the time window that works best for you. Have the client PCs backed up to the central Essentials server. So this is really great. It allows you to restore files and folders and even do a full bare metal restore of the entire PC. So you can think of cases, a number of different cases where this is going to be helpful, but as one example, maybe you have a client computer, it goes home for the weekend, and something happens, it gets a virus or some kind of malware, and when it comes back into the office, the user is complaining of problems, you can simply wipe that out entirely and restore it to a full backup from, you know, before the weekend started. So you can go back to last Friday's backup or whatever is most appropriate and completely eradicate any of the problems that that may have occurred. It also supports Volume Shadow services, Volume Shadow Copy services, the VSS Writer for backup and restore, so that it's a very robust protection. Next, we also have file history integration. So if you have newer Windows 8, Windows 8.1 operating system on your client PCs, then you're able to enable file history integration. And this is a great complement to full PC backup in that while it only protects individual files and folders, it's something that end users can use on their own. They don't need administrative assistance in order to restore files and folders. So some things that we've done to make the file history integration better with 2012 R2, it's now enabled on a per user basis rather than just a per PC basis. So this makes it a lot easier, especially for folks who are sharing a PC. It also makes it nice if a user gets a new computer, then when they log in, they sign into that new computer, the file history integration will know that all of their data that's stored centrally on the server as file history data is missing from this new PC or laptop or whatever the case may be, and can copy that back to this new computer so that the user can get up and going again very quickly and back to the data that they had. So a nice way to kind of do an automatic restore. Again, file history does not require any administrative assistance in order to work. As you do use the file history integration, you can select which folders to protect, the documents folder, the desktop for the end users, the libraries, contacts, favorites, all these different things. All of the typical profile data except libraries of media are protected by default. You can also set up the desired frequency, whether that's once every 10 minutes or up to once a day, so that you can kind of control how often the file history is being done. And you can also set a retention policy. So the more the longer term the retention policy is, of course, the more disk space is going to be consumed by that file history, but the more flexible it will be in terms of what you can recover from. And then the shorter the retention period is, the reverse is true. You'd take less disk space, but you wouldn't have as many choices for how far in the past you could go to recover from an accidentally deleted or overwritten file. And then, of course, we have Windows Server Backup itself. So this is how you protect the actual Essentials server, or the server running the Essentials experience. And this just leverages the backup feature, the backup feature that's available with Windows Server 2012 R2. It would just make it a little easier to use. Just put a wizard in front of that and expose it in the dashboard so that it's easy to see the status and make sure everything is happening as it should. It supports very large volumes, and it can do similar to the client PC backup, where you can restore individual files or folders, you can restore individual volumes to the server, and you can also do a full bare metal recovery of the server itself. So you just boot back from the installation media, and instead of choosing install, you can choose repair, and that kicks off the Windows pre-installation environment, and you can choose to restore your server from your backup destination media, which is typically a removable external hard drive that you would use. And it's definitely recommended to use multiple of these USB drives or whatever external removable device that you're using, and then rotate those off-site. And it could be as simple as just having a couple, and one is taken home by someone at the end of each day or week or whatever the case may be. You could get fancier and rent a safety deposit box and store them there. Anything to take it physically off-site and away from the server, so that if there is some kind of catastrophe, some kind of fire or theft or flood or something, that you still have your data in a secure place that you can then restore. Next, in order to control access to the data that you have and protect it from who can access what, we do leverage Active Directory for user management, and this provides the mechanism for authentication as well as authorization on what you can access. So we've simplified this process again. The native tools are still there, of course, underneath of the dashboard interface. But as you use the dashboard to create user accounts, then you simply can choose whether they're a standard user or an administrative user. And typically, you would want to log in and do your day-to-day work as a standard user and only use an administrator account when you're actually going to do some management of the server. Now, by default, the built-in administrator account is disabled, and the setup process will prompt you to create a new user account that you can designate as an administrator, and that's what you would use to do those management tasks. You can also choose to integrate with a messaging and collaboration system. So this could either be cloud-based, like Office 365, or a third-party hosted Exchange solution, or it can be running on-premises on a second server. So this could be Exchange server running on a second server, or it could be running in a virtual machine, whatever the case may be. And then when you choose to integrate the Essentials environment with a messaging infrastructure, then as you create your user accounts, you can create an associated mailbox at the same time. So it's very easy to have user accounts and mailboxes managed together, just like we would have in Windows Small Business Server, as an example. One of the other things that's new, in addition to be able to create user accounts, is now to be able to create security groups. And if you have the email integration, you can create email distribution groups as well. So previously, when these features and functionality were only available in the Essentials Edition, which has a license limitation of up to 25 users, it wasn't as important to have security groups, because you could assign access to resources user by user. If you only have 5 users or even 10 users, that's not necessarily a big deal. But as you grow, you have 30 users, 40 users, 50 users, and so on. Organizing users into groups and then using those security groups to assign and control access to resources really simplifies things and makes a lot of sense. So that's been added now to the Essentials experience. And we can also set a policy around passwords, so how complex they are, what the length needs to be, whether or not they expire, and so on. And so in this way, again, this provides us with that layer of data protection in terms of controlling access to files and folders and other resources in the environment. Another thing that we've done to make it easier to make sure that the environment is healthy is to provide some robust but simple to use monitoring. So this can help customers as well as partners who serve them monitor the status of the environment, security status, update status, so on and so forth, and not just for the Essentials server itself, but also for other servers in the environment, as well as all of the client computers in the environment. And then the alerts that are generated, they can be sent to either the customer, the admin person for the customer, or they can be sent to partners. And alerts are as typically done, collected into 3 tiers of severity. We just have informational, as well as warning and critical alerts that give some indication on how quickly or how serious the problem is, how quickly you might need to address it. So in addition to telling you that something is wrong or there's a potential issue, each alert also provides prescriptive guidance to give you some idea of how to resolve it, what the resolution might be. And in many alerts, we even have a link that will take you directly to the tool or the resource that you can use to resolve that issue. So we've also integrated a reporting aspect of this as well, so that you can generate reports automatically on a daily basis and choose to have those emailed out. And you can define who the recipients are, you can customize the report, and you can determine the schedule that you want to use in order to send those out. So really some good and robust health monitoring that's provided by the Essentials experience. And then, as I mentioned earlier, the idea of supporting business continuity, and this is really facilitated by running Essentials as a virtual machine. And once you're running as a virtual machine, you can take advantage of Hyper-V Replica. And this allows you to basically copy the entire virtual machine its definition, its metadata, as well as its virtual disks, from a primary site to a replica site, and that replica site is generally at a different physical location, although you could certainly replicate across the room. But very, very often what we'll see happen is a partner who has multiple customers would have, that partner would have a server on their site and then have their customers replicate to that server, so that this is now a new service offering that partners can have for their customers and provide them with this level of business continuity. So you can do this on a very affordable basis. Hyper-V replica is just a feature of Hyper-V, so there's nothing more to buy. From a partner's investment standpoint, you would just need to have a server and license it appropriately to run as many virtual machines as you might need to have at any one time. So you could do a little thin provisioning in terms of licensing here. If you have a server that is used to protect, say, a half a dozen customers, then maybe you just need one copy of Windows Server Standard so you could run two virtual machines at a time. Or if you want to be safe, you can stack three copies of Windows Server Standard, three licenses assigned to the same central replica server so that you could run all six replicas at the same time. Or if you're doing it on a grander scale, you could just have one copy of data center and then you could have unlimited number of virtual machines running in the case of some kind of widespread disaster. But you can do this in a much more affordable way for the customers and for the infrastructure that's needed to provide some basic disaster recovery options that compare very well against traditional offerings in this space. And in terms of your ability to recover, Replica can be synchronized as little as every 30 seconds to as often or as long as every 15 minutes. Although typically you kind of split it in the middle and replicate every 5 minutes. But again, it's going to depend entirely on the workload that you have, on the network connectivity that you have between the primary virtual machine and the replica virtual machine and different things like that. This is done securely through HTTPS, so secure web traffic basically, and you don't need any super sophisticated shared storage type infrastructure. This is an asynchronous replication, so really, again, makes it easy to kind of get started. So that's a little bit on Hyper-V Replica. There's a ton more information available on TechNet, so if that's something that you're interested in pursuing, I'd highly encourage you to learn more about that. There's a great virtual lab that we have as well that'll allow you to practice this with a couple of virtual machines. You can fire up the virtual lab and have a step-by-step lab guide that will walk you through all the steps of configuring Hyper-V Replica, how it works when you fail over, how the clients behave, and things like that. So you can get a really good sense of how this goes pretty easily. So the next aspect then is providing secure remote access. So as we know, more and more people are working remotely, they have mobile devices, and they want to be able to access the information in the Essentials environment. So whether you're just simply trying to access your files and folders, whether you want to remotely connect to PCs that are running in the office, perhaps you have a PC that's running a specific application that you want to connect to, or you're just wanting to do some light admin tasks. So if somebody needs their password reset, or you want to check to see if there are any alerts on the server or know what they are. These are all the things that you might want to do, and then the tools that you have to do that include the remote web access portal, the My Server app for Windows, so this could be for any Windows 8 computer, laptop, tablet, so on, and we also have a My Server app for your Windows phone. So let's take a look at these. So initially, the remote web access is something that we've had for a very, very long time, and in fact, it was called the remote web workplace prior to that. And this gives a way to just use a web browser to access the server. You can remotely access shared folders. You can upload, download, and interact with the files. You can also use this as a gateway to remotely access computers that are running and just use it as if you were sitting right in front of it. Now, one thing to note here is just the idea that when you're using the Essentials Edition, then there are no additional licensing requirements. But if you're running the Essentials Experience with the Standard or Data Center editions, then you will need RDS CALs for those users who do connect remotely to computers in the network. And this is because RWA leverages the RD Gateway role service of the RDS role in order to facilitate this. You have other options as well to connect remotely to computers in the environment. We talk about this in the seventh module in this series, the User Experience module. You can also establish a VPN connection from a remote computer to the server, and that would let you just use RDP directly to connect to a remote PC. And there's different pros and cons to each approach, and some things are more straightforward when you're using RWA, and so then you can choose whether or not you want to use one method or the other, depending on the needs of the business and the needs of the user. You can also access the dashboard remotely. You can do that, again, connect through the RWA portal and perform administrative tasks. And end users can also change their own password remotely using the RWA portal. As we look at the MyServer app for Windows, this is a free download from the Microsoft Store. This is actually one of the unique benefits that this particular method provides, is being able to work with files offline and then having those files be automatically synchronized back to the Essentials server when you have an internet connection again. So as you use the MyServer app to access the shared folders on the server remotely, then it's just going to cache a copy to that particular device. So again, allowing you to work offline. It also provides the same type of light administration functionality that we've had in the previous version of the MyServer app. It's also available on the MyServer app for Windows Phone. So you can view alerts, you can view the users in the environment, you can enable or disable user accounts, reset passwords, you can also see the devices in the environment. So not intended to replace using the dashboard for administration, but to be able to quickly see what's happening with your server and to do some basic light administration tasks on the go. And then finally, we have the MyServer app for Windows Phone. So here it's organized into a number of different tiles, including a status tile where you can kind of see a summary of the environment, as well as a server tile where, again, you can see alerts and the devices and users, as well as some settings that you can adjust. You also have a files panel, and this is where you'd see the shared folders in the environment, so you can open up and access different files from the server. You also have a tile that shows your recent activity, so you can go ahead and more quickly, more easily start working with the files that you have used in the recent past. And then finally, if you install the optional media capabilities for the Essentials Experience, then there is a media panel, and you can use this to stream music or videos or pictures from the server to the phone. And this is a great way to just carry around promotional videos or different training videos or what have you, and to allow people to access those on the go. So the last pillar then for the Essentials Experience is integration with cloud-based services. So again, we know that we're in a period of hybrid IT where we have applications and services that are running on-premises, that are local to the users and the network environment that they're in, and we also have applications and services that are running in the cloud. And we want to make it easy to facilitate that hybrid IT approach. So one of the big things, of course, is email integration. And so we have the flexibility to integrate with email no matter where it's running. So you could be using an Office 365 subscription and have your email and SharePoint and so on in the cloud. You can also be using an Exchange server that's running on-premises, and it would integrate in the same way. And you can also choose to use a third-party host Exchange provider, and they can also provide an add-in for email integration to manage their service. And all of these options then provide that integrated mailbox management that's associated with the user accounts. So as you create a user account, you can also create their mailbox that goes with them. Some new Office 365 integration that we have with the 2012 R2 version includes SharePoint Online Library integration. So now you can see these libraries within the dashboard. There's different types of libraries that you can create, and you can manage the permissions of these libraries as well. So again, more details in future modules about how this works. And then another area that we've taken advantage of is Exchange Active Sync. So we can do some basic management of the mobile devices. So you can see the connected devices that you have, which users are using which device to connect remotely to the environment. You can configure a password policy to protect these devices so that users may need a PIN and the device may automatically lock after a certain number of minutes so that they need to enter that PIN, control how long it is, and things of that nature. You also have the ability to block access from particular mobile devices. So let's say, for example, that some kind of security issue has been discovered around a particular set of devices, and you might want to block access from those devices until that security issue has been resolved for all of your users, and then you can go ahead and allow access again. And of course, you can finally do remote wipe, which is a way to protect the device if it ever is lost or stolen. You don't want any sensitive business information to remain on the device, and so that you can wipe it out remotely. We also have the ability to integrate with Windows Azure Backup. So this is a great complement to the Windows Server Backup that happens locally. It is not intended to be necessarily a replacement for Windows Server Backup, because what it does is focus on protecting individual files and folders. So you would select which shared folders in the environment that you would want to back up to the cloud. And then you'd be able to restore those, you know, in the case of a catastrophic disaster at your local site. But what Azure Backup doesn't do is protect the system state of the server. So you couldn't do like a bare metal restore, for example. But it is a great way and a very easy and convenient way to gain a layer of offsite protection for the most business critical data that you have. So you know that it's safe and secure, that the facility that it's stored in, the Azure data center, is very much protected, and so gives you that extra peace of mind. So it integrates right with the dashboard so that you can manage it like you would manage the rest of the environment, so it makes it very easy to use. And this is the same integration that's used across all of the different versions of Windows Server, but the additional integration with the Essentials experience just simplifies the management and makes it integrated throughout the, like I said, the dashboard experience. So a great way to, again, complement the backups that you're doing and add an additional layer of data protection. So that's a quick overview of the Essentials experience. As I mentioned, in additional modules throughout this series, we'll take a closer look at each one of those and dial into the details and explain how it works, how you can do the management of those different areas, as well as the user experience of taking advantage of those different features and functionality. And I just wanted to wrap things up with a quick recap of what we talked about. So again, using the Essentials experience to protect your data, to provide secure remote access, and to integrate with cloud-based applications and services. So a really great way to have that hybrid IT environment. So some additional resources to learn more. We have a lot more technical information available in the Windows Server Essentials Tech Center, so I'd encourage you to check that out. We also have a very active blog. So the not only does the development team write articles about features and different feature areas, we also have our customer service and support folks who write articles about things that come up, things that you need to know about, or how to resolve issues in the environment. We also have marketing articles that are used to announce new things and just give you a sense of what's going on. So highly encourage you to check out the blog. An RSS feed is a very convenient and easy way to go in terms of being able to just stay up to date on what's happening with Essentials. We also have a very active support forum. And again, not only does the development team monitor the forum, but we also have a really great community of MVPs who are very active here in helping out. So if you have a question, comment, if you want to talk about this training as an example, or just just anything that's happening in your environment, I would love to see you join us in the support forum. We also have our product pages for Windows Server 2012 R2, and we have a page specifically for the Essentials Edition. And from here, you can download data sheets and white papers, and also link to the trials of these products so that you can download the bits and start playing with them. So please do check those out. And also for the partners who are watching, I wanted to give you a link to the Ahead of the Game campaign resources. So please do check these out. A lot of information here, and a lot of resources that you can use to help educate your customers on the benefits of Windows Server and the Essentials experience. We also have a number of other partner resources that you can leverage, so I wanted to include this for your reference here in the deck. And then also a summary of how to buy Windows Server 2012 R2 and the different editions, what they're best suited for, a quick comparison of their features and the licensing model. And also have some links for product and licensing resources. So again, just wanted to include these so that you had those quickly available as a resource that you could take away from this training. And then finally, some of the different licensing programs that are especially focused on the small and mid-sized business segment. So again, wanted to include those for your reference. So with that, I wanted to thank you very much for joining me for today's presentation, for this overview of the Essentials experience. And I do hope that you'll join us for the other modules in this series.